Good morning, all. Welcome to the 2017 Martin Luther King Jr. Day. My name is Akira Towns, and I am a senior here at Bates. I'm also a member of the MLK Day Committee. During my time at Bates, MLK Day has always been a day that I look forward to. But this year, with it being my last MLK Day as a Bates student, and with the current state of our world, I find that I am excited to delve deeper into reflecting on the progress and the efforts that have been and can be made towards the rights and equality for all people. Today, we will be hearing from some great speakers, including our keynote presenter, Dr. Khalil Muhammad. Throughout the day, there will be many workshops, panels, and discussions that I hope you enjoy and learn from. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Matt Auer. I'm the Dean of the Faculty and Vice President for Academic Affairs, and I want to welcome you to this college's celebration of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday. For many years, Bates has recognized this national holiday as an opportunity to do what colleges do best, which is to reflect and to reason, but to do so with attention to the particular legacy of Dr. King, including the considerable unfinished business of his life's work, which is actually the nation's work. Each program revolves around a particular theme or set of concerns requiring collective contemplation and action. And this year, we consider the matter of reparations, addressing racial injustices. In his 1963 book-length call to action, Why We Can't Wait, Dr. King himself offered a broadly conceived, intentionally inclusive remedy in the form of a, quote, Bill of Rights for the disadvantaged, a program that he compared to the GI Bill. In a similar vein, today we will explore reparations and racial injustice as matters of public policy and of moral urgency. Our program offers many ways into the conversation from both disciplinary and interdisciplinary perspectives. Our subject matter ranges from white appropriation of black cultural production to the catalyzing of collective action to address deteriorating police-community relations, to the high-walled pathway to prison that begins with racial injustice in preschool. The geography of our subject matter spans Korea to Colombia and Somalia to Lewiston. The media and materials for our work range from presentations, workshops, and readings to performance. And our presenters, moderators, and guides include our own faculty, staff, and students, and a variety of distinguished guests. Following a welcome from President Spencer, Dr. Yannick Marshall will introduce our keynote speaker, Khalil Muhammad. And from there, the challenge of the subject matter is compounded by the challenge of deciding how to sample rich presentations and workshops that take place concurrently. Please consult your program for the contents and locations of session number one, workshops that take place between 10:45 and 12:15. Bates offers lunch at a special price in Commons from 12:30 to 1 p.m. It's a crisp half hour for the midday meal because the afternoon and evening are rich with programming, and in fact, we have a book discussion taking place on the second floor of Commons. So grab lunch and join the conversation about Stephen Wilder's book, Ebony and Ivory, Race, Slavery, and the Troubled History of America's Universities. Session two workshops begin at 2 p.m., and the annual Dr. Benjamin Elijah Mays Class of 1920 debate featuring student debaters from Morehouse College and Bates College takes place from 3:45 to 5 p.m. in Olin Hall. There's a hip-hop dance workshop in Schaefer Theater at 5:15, and Sankofa presents the multimedia evening program at Schaefer at 7:30 p.m. Your program mentions additional activities taking place on Tuesday, but the conversations and presentations we join today are meant to have lasting impact and import well beyond either today or tomorrow. My thanks to all of the groups and individuals who are sponsoring MLK Day activities, especially to the many student groups. I'd like to offer my sincere thanks to the individuals who work throughout the year to plan our Martin Luther King Day Junior observance. Permit me to recognize the members of the planning committee. When I read your name, may I ask that you stand and remain standing, and will the audience members please hold your applause until I've read all the names. Monet Blakely, Darius Campbell, Rachel Chappell, Regine Clowden Mallett, Daniel Cohen, Lauren Drumgold, Phyllis Graber Jensen, Jan Hovden, Gwen Laxau, Brittany Longstorff, Melanie McGuire, Julia Meal, Brenda Pelletier, Christopher Petrella, James Reese, Michael Roque, Susan Stark, Mara Teakin, Akira Towns, Huang Tran, Crystal Williams. Please join me in thanking all of these program organizers. The MLK Day Planning Committee co-chairs are Michael Roque, Susan Stark, and Mara Teakin. I'm especially grateful to them for their inspired leadership and deep commitment to the work of this committee. Thank you, Michael, Susan, and Mara in particular. It's my pleasure to turn the podium over to President Clayton Spencer, who will offer words of welcome.
Wow, this is a fantastic, fantastic gathering and crowd. Good morning, everyone, and welcome. It is really terrific to see so many of you here this morning, coming together as we do every January to reflect on the challenges and responsibilities of our common humanity and to honor the legacy and commit to the ongoing work of Martin Luther King Jr. Many of us have felt the challenges and responsibilities of engaging with our common humanity keenly in the recent weeks and months. We have just lived through a very intense and divisive year politically, and we are about to begin life under new leadership, around which there is much unknown, much that we've taken for granted, but now feels unsettled and unsure. For some of us, this is perhaps a relatively new feeling. For others, fear, uncertainty, and unease are simply called living in the United States of America. As today's speaker, Professor Khalil Gibran Muhammad, has written as recently as yesterday in the New York Times, injustice and violence have been with us in this country since our founding. Our history cannot be told, though it often is, without the narratives of the slave trade, of slavery, of Jim Crow, of the battle for civil rights, for economic justice, for freedom from state violence. This year's Martin Luther King Jr. Day takes on this history in our chosen theme, which you heard from Matt Auer, Reparations, Addressing Racial Injustices. Reparations begin with acknowledgement. So today's topic challenges us to ask ourselves how we can move beyond the fantasy of self-deception and comfortable vanity that Dr. King warned us of in 1967, a fantasy that assumes that American society is hospitable to fair play and that steady progress towards racial harmony is inevitable. Reparations may sound like a straightforward concept, but in his award-winning article in 2014, The Case for Reparations, Ta-Nehisi Coates lays bare the complexity of this undertaking. These are his words. Reparations, by which I mean the full acceptance of our collective biography and its consequences, is the price we must pay to see ourselves squarely. The recovering alcoholic may well have to live with his illness for the rest of his life, but at least he is not living a drunken lie. Reparations beckons us to reject the intoxication of hubris and see America as it is, the work of fallible humans. What is needed is an airing of family secrets, a settling with old ghosts. What I'm talking about is more than recompense for past injustices, more than a handout, a payoff, hush money, or a reluctant bribe. What I'm talking about is a national reckoning that would lead to spiritual renewal. Reparations would mean a revolution of the American consciousness, a reconciling of our self-image as the great democratizer with the facts of our history. We are fortunate today to have with us a brilliant guide through the questions of reparation and justice, Dr. Mohammed of Harvard's Kennedy School of Government. Welcome, Dr. Mohammed, and thank you for being here with us. In his recent book, Condemnation of Blackness, Race, Crime, and the Making of Modern Urban America, Dr. Mohammed, a historian by training, elegantly and convincingly demonstrates how the actions and movements of a moment are rooted in the assumptions that preceded them. Dr. Mohammed has said that no moment in time exists where race is not a primary factor in the treatment of Black people. And so the crime issue, if we just equate crime or criminalization and racial stigma, there is no moment where race is not an organizing principle for how Black people's behavior is defined in American society. We need to reinvent a new narrative, he says, so that America can actually be something different than what it has been beyond the limitations of race and inequality. The how of this sort of transformative reinvestment is by no means easily conceived or enacted. But part of the answer to the who, the where, and the when begins with gatherings like this today. Many of you will recognize Dr. Mohammed's first names as those of the poet Khalil Gibran, in whose words we may find additional inspiration for this day and for the work ahead. Safeguarding the rights of others is the most noble and beautiful end of a human being, he said. Thank you, Dr. Mohammed. Thank you, Bates community and guests. Thank you all for being here today, for listening and speaking, and for moving us forward. I will now turn things over to Yannick Marshall, visiting instructor in African American and American Cultural Studies, who will give Dr. Mohammed a proper introduction. Thank you.
It's a great privilege to be able to introduce Dr. Khalil Gibran Mohammed, professor of history, race, and public policy at Harvard Kennedy School, and the Suzanne Young Murray Professor at the Radcliffe Institute of Advanced Study, also at Harvard. I remember the days when Breitbart.com used to have a link on its homepage entitled Black Crime. It's a strange thing that we know what they're referring to. It's strange, too, that black is harder to pin down. Ask what blackness is or black culture and prepare for a debate. Seek to define and locate black people and chase an ever-receding margin. But black crime has a certain fixity. We know what that is. In his book, The Condemnation of Blackness, Race, Crime, and the Making of Modern Urban America, Dr. Mohammed locates the moments blacks first emerged as a distant and dangerous criminal class. The 1890s prison census and statistics gathering, he shows us, became the basis of a national conversation about black criminality. At that moment, statistics and data about black crime became a new language with which the Negro problem was discussed. Crime was then affixed to the Negro body. Wedding black and crime, blending one with the other, so that the presence of the black body carries inscribed upon it the chill wind and anxiety of criminality, so that the criminal is imagined as black first and always, unless and until further clarification is warranted, creates a singular target of elimination. Du Bois and Ida B. Wells, Dr. Muhammad notes, labor tirelessly to deracialize black criminality, to delink blackness and crime. They failed. Today, Black Lives Matter stands over the same spot, trying to pry blackness away from the clutches of crime, to grab life, lives, worth from targeting and elimination. In a succinct and powerful 2012 article written for the New York Times, soon after the killing of Trayvon Martin, Dr. Muhammad noted that while almost everyone is familiar with the charge of pulling the race card, a term used to discredit real or imagined cries of racism, people seem less aware of another practice, something that he calls pulling the violence card. This is when faced with an instance of apparently clear, racially charged anti-black violence, attention is deflected and drawn to black-on-black violence, or violence in the black community. In order to discredit or distract from uncomfortably clear and damning evidence of anti-black racism, not only is Dr. Muhammad's term, pulling the violence card, essential to understanding racism and cognitive dissonance in contemporary American society, but I'd submit that the fact that Dr. Muhammad had to make this intercession at all is in itself evidence of the marginalization and invisibility of black life. If at every instance of racist state-sponsored anti-black killing, we all know that somebody somewhere is bound to say, what about black-on-black violence? If this is inevitable and predictable, why didn't pulling that card have a name? Why did Dr. Muhammad have to intercede, point out, highlight, and explain this technique of discrediting claims of racial violence to us? And why, on the other hand, is the phrase "you're playing the race card" so easily accessible? Here, Dr. Muhammad's theory in the land of black invisibility must work two jobs: work to present the critique, then doubling back to present itself as evidence. Dr. Muhammad was born in Chicago and did an economics degree at the University of Pennsylvania. His plans to go on to work in finance were rerouted after witnessing the Rodney King torture and the O.J. Simpson trial. And then he was led to devoting more time to thinking about race and society. He rejoined the academy and received his PhD in history from Rutgers, and went on to become a postdoctoral fellow at the Vera Institute for Justice. Before Harvard, Dr. Muhammad was the director of the Schomburg Center of Research in Black Culture in Harlem, a center that has benefited me personally in innumerable ways, as it has many aspiring scholars and community members dedicated to thinking and being around thoughts about race and society. He is an eminent scholar, writer, public intellectual, and educator. Please help me welcome Dr. Khalil Muhammad.
Good morning, everyone. I am really honored to be here. My first visit to Bates College, my first moment on the soil of Maine, and it's been nothing but positive. So Thank you for your generosity of spirit and for what today means to us gathered here, but also to the world we live in. I want to thank Dr. Marshall. That was really terrific, far beyond anything I actually deserve. And I'm grateful that you shared some of the work that I've done around racial criminalization, mass incarceration, because I won't talk that much about that today. So we've all been complimenting each other and not knowing it. I also want to thank President Clayton Spencer for your leadership here, for the model that you set in establishing a community and helping to carry for a community that cares deeply about the world that we live in. To Vice President Matthew Auer, who, as it turns out, is a friend from Bloomington, Indiana. We were colleagues together when he was there teaching and running the Honors College. So it's a pleasure to reconnect and be here with you. To Mara Teakin, Susan Stark, Mark Roque, as co-chairs for the MLK Day, thank you for your leadership, for your commitment to this community. I want to thank James Reese, the Associate Dean of Students. They don't make them like you anymore. And I've been fortunate to get to travel lots of different places and to meet lots of wonderful people, and you're a standout, so thank you. And I'm especially grateful to my friend, Associate Vice President Crystal Williams, for her friendship, for her leadership, example that she sets for all of us. She's melting into the wood paneling back there, but I see you, and so I want to thank her as well. And finally, again, to all of you. For those of you who are freshmen, I remember my first King Day, the first time I celebrated this life. I was a freshman at the University of Pennsylvania in 1989, just after the holiday had been passed. 3 years later, a columnist for the Daily Pennsylvania, the student newspaper, called the King holiday a sham because Dr. King was a communist who wanted to take money from white people to give to black people. The same columnist went on to call affirmative action a dirty little secret because it promoted black mediocrity over white excellence. I organized some folks by my junior year to respond to the columnist. A university officer suggested that I debate the columnist, and I know Morehouse will be debating Bates College later. It's an August tradition. And that's when, in the face of this invitation, my life changed forever. I was terrified by my own fears of losing. I was ashamed that I didn't actually know enough about Dr. King to represent the truth. I was ignorant of my own history. Today is much harder to ignore Dr. King, if for no other reason than the fact that he is carved in granite, emerging out of a stone of hope. King, of course, as you know, is now on the National Mall, a place no other non-president has ever held until now, let alone a black man. But like so much of the history of monuments and commemorations in this country, we risk missing the real legacy of the man. Dr. King was not a leader who was satisfied with milestones and benchmarks. His was not a vision of hope and change measured in polling data and political trends. As he grew into the fullness of his calling on earth, as he evolved from a 25-year-old rookie pastor of the biggest black church in Montgomery, Alabama, to become the greatest civil rights icon in the 20th century, a span of 14 years, Dr. King kept his eyes on the prize of human rights, of peace, and a dogged determination to ensure that all would not just sit at the table of equality, but would eat there too. By 1966, Dr. King saw discrimination as evil and as resistant to change in the freedom-loving North in my hometown of Chicago, that to him demonstrated the law was not enough. Here was post-civil rights America turned upside down in the resistance of white homeowners to allow blacks to live next door. No laws were on the books, just bigotry and subterfuge, a wily realtor, a redlining banker, and an occasional Molotov cocktail when all else failed. Dr. King recognized that in the early days of the post-civil rights era, real change came slowly, if at all. And indeed, in some instances, new forms of bigotry and discrimination, new structural barriers to equality were being constructed. Only now they were more resistant to protest and reform, like a superbacteria that grows stronger when its host only attacks piecemeal. You know, when you don't take your antibiotics for the full 10 days, the strain of bacteria morphs into something worse than it was when it first entered the body. Five generations ago, many Americans believed then that the heavy lifting of building racial democracy had been completed. What better proof, they claimed, than the election of more than a dozen African Americans to the United States Congress? From the 1870s through the turn of the 20th century, 14 black men served in the U.S. House of Representatives, and 2 black men served in the U.S. Senate. Undeniably, these were historic times, watershed events, and moments for great optimism. South Carolina's Congressman Joseph H. Rainey served from 1870 to 1879, an ex-slave and barber by profession. Mississippi Congressman John R. Lynch served 2 terms, ending in 1883, a formerly enslaved man turned lawyer and photographer. Hiram Revels was the nation's first black senator, who also became the first president of Alcorn State University. And Blanche K. Bruce, the second African-American senator, served until 1881, when shortly after he became a U.S. Treasury official and the first black person to have his signature on U.S. currency. They were both from the Magnolia State, from Mississippi, later dubbed the American Congo by historians for the brutal exploitation of black sharecroppers for much of the 20th century. Mississippi, to just pause for a moment, is a state whose official flag to this day has the inset of the Confederate flag in its upper right corner. It is a state whose former governor, Haley Barbour, thinks that when the former governor, formerly released from prison, Virginia, Bob McDonald, declared a few years ago that April was Confederate History Month, but managed to leave out any mention of slavery in the proclamation. In response to the complaints of the great citizens of Virginia with this deliberate omission, Mr. Barbour said, trying to make a big deal about something that doesn't amount to diddly, anybody that thinks that you have to explain to people that slavery is a bad thing, I think that goes without saying. This is precisely how the tyranny of ignorance proceeds. In this way, it makes perfect sense that there is no point mentioning slavery as the cause of the Civil War, or teaching white, black, and brown children that black people's unfree labor literally built the wall in timber and earth that we call Wall Street today, under which 20,000 enslaved Africans' bodies rest eternally, and whose souls testify to the labor that fueled the profits of banks and corporations and gave America her competitive advantage in the world. It was in New York City, not Birmingham, Alabama, where some of the first slave codes were written to keep black folk from gathering to pray or to nurture mutual bonds of affection, even to network. One law in 1731 stated, "No Negro, mulatto, or Indian slaves above the number of 3 do assemble or meet together in the Lord's day called Sunday and sport, play, or make any noise or disturbance or at any other time at any place from their master's service within this city." Business dealings or market transactions usually involving small amounts of fruits, vegetables, and hand-stitched clothing were explicitly outlawed. America's economic history, as we heard a little bit in the early morning session, is indelibly marked by the contributions of black people. Numerous historians have run the numbers in our numbers-obsessed world. According to Ira Berlin, one of the nation's leading slavery experts, and I quote, "The American economy was founded upon the production of slave-grown crops, the great staples of tobacco, rice, sugar, and finally cotton, which slave owners sold on the international market to bring capital into the colonies and then the young republic. That capital eventually funded the creation of an infrastructure upon which rests 3 centuries of American economic success. In 1860, the 4 million American slaves were conservatively valued at $3 billion. That sum was almost 3 times the value of the entire American manufacturing establishment of all the railroads in the United States, about 7 times the net worth of all the banks, and some 48 times the expenditures of the federal government. It is no wonder that U.S. slaveholders, one of the wealthiest group of people in the 19th century world, were willing to go to war against their countrymen, to die to preserve their way of life. And lest our children never know, out of fear that this history is divisive, the majority of this nation's presidents were indeed wealthy slave owners: George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, James Monroe, Andrew Jackson, John Tyler, James Polk, and Zachary Taylor. 2 of the nation's founding chief justices, John Marshall and Roger Taney, also counted among them. Slavery is not aberration in the American story. It is the quintessential American story. No other republic in the world depended as heavily or for so long on slave labor for its economic power, and no other nation has reaped the rewards as handsomely as this country. Every year, America celebrates Holocaust Remembrance Day. In 2012, President Obama, who has convened these annual celebrations over the course of his 2 terms, said this: "We must tell our children, but more than that, we must teach them. Because remembrance without resolve is a hollow gesture. Awareness without action changes nothing. In this sense, never again is a challenge to us all to pause and to look within. Since it is not okay to teach our children to deny the Jewish Holocaust, then why is it okay in far too many schools and homes to deny the centrality of slavery to the American story? The transatlantic slavery experience changed the course of history. It was a product of a historical moment that witnessed the rise of global capital. In this case, the market for human beings, gold, sugar, rum, cotton, and so on. Slavery cannot slip into the dark recesses of our memories because it's too painful, or we worry that our children will lose hope for the future. It is what made this nation rich. It is part of our DNA. Too often, as a consequence of our ignorance of our past, change and progress have been short-lived and history forgotten. How many, for example, sit here today having never heard of Rainey or Revels, Lynch or Bruce? How many can truly talk with any authority on Reconstruction's demise? Indeed, only as of January 12th has the nation for the first time created a national monument to the Reconstruction era. Under President Obama, now Beaufort, South Carolina, the home of Robert Smalls, the great anti-slavery activist who stole a Confederate war vessel, delivered it to the US Navy in the opening days of the Civil War, one of the first places that established Black independence land ownership, established the Penn School, which to this day continues to educate, a place that Dr. King himself sought sustenance and encouragement. But going back to Reconstruction's demise, this was the moment when the nation's political winds changed directions, loosening Black people's foothold on the mountaintop. The federal government bounced its first check to Black Americans while white Democrats took back the South with violence and subterfuge. By 1880, there were no more Black senators. By 1896, segregation was legalized. By 1901, no Black congressmen. George H. White, the North Carolina ex-slave turned lawyer, was the last Black man to turn the lights off in the chambers of Congress for more than a generation. Why the grand experiment in racial democracy had come to a precipitous end, it would take much of the rest of the 20th century to return Black people to the political status quo of the 19th century. Indeed, it took 125 years, with the 2004 election of Senator Barack Obama to surpass the number of black senators who had served briefly in the 1870s. Dr. King once said of racial ignorance, "A good many observers have remarked that if equality could come at once, the Negro would not be ready for it." I submit that the white American is even more unprepared, he said. Whites, it must be frankly said, are not putting a similar mass effort to re-educate themselves out of their racial ignorance, out of their superiority that they have so little to learn. One of my favorite stories about Dr. King's own sense of history and its importance, something that I think we've often overlooked in the infinite sound bites that come from his amazing prose. He tells a story that he and Coretta attended one of the annual school assemblies in Atlanta when their children were young. This was an homage to the great musical traditions of America. And he writes, "As we listened to the folk songs and melodies of the various immigrant groups, we were certain that the program would end with the most original of all American music, the Negro spiritual. But we were mistaken. Instead, all the students, including our children, ended the program by singing Dixie." So how do we fix this? We need a new origin story of this nation. We need to focus our attention systemically on something that might be awkwardly named at this moment, racial education. I leave it to others, more poetic, to Crystal, to help us come up with a better label, but that is in effect what I am describing here. I mean a revised civic lesson, a new meta-narrative, something on a scale never attempted in the country to revise the American exceptionalism we've all been taught. No reparations of any kind, of any enduring and impactful significance can proceed without it. Practically speaking, then, how do we take 50 years of social history from the margins of our K through 16 educational system and put it at the center? This isn't just about Howard Zinn's People's History of the United States, though I'll take that over what's currently taught. This is about committing ourselves to historical and humanistic literacy that draws on advances in historical reasoning, archival evidence, and literary analysis that reflects what we have learned over a half century, the work that you do every day here. Too often we treat history like it is an opinion. I've served on national and local committees to solve this problem or that, and I've watched educated people evoke their own experiences as historical proof. We all have opinions, but we are not all historically literate, never mind fluent. The same problem of climate change denial holds in how most Americans think about our past. We at least give economists, environmentalists a chance to shake our beliefs. Historians, not so much. The former editor of Harper's Magazine, Lewis Latham, wrote a few years ago in the magazine that there is a, quote, "increasingly illiterate populace to be as poorly informed about American history as they are about the history of ancient Egypt or modern Uzbekistan. 76% of college graduates unfamiliar with the Bill of Rights, 73% of respondents unable to identify America's antagonists during the four decades of the Cold War." He said Americans have a wonderful talent for grand simplification. Why then argue for uses of history other than the ones that sponsor the election campaigns, blow the bubbles on Wall Street, underwrite the nation's wars? Admittedly, there is no trans-ideological view of the past. The questions we ask, the evidence we seek, the data we collect, the frames we choose, the audiences we write for and against all make history messy. These biases make our empirical work messy too, despite the ubiquity of big data and transcendent claims of objectivity. But that messiness is exactly what we have to wrestle with at the earliest possible age if our citizens are to be global humanists, if they are to see themselves in a larger story where they have agency, where they make choices, and where they may choose to minimize inequality as a moral or ethical imperative. Just to give one important index of the scale of this problem, in 2013, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences published a report called The Heart of the Matter. As director of the Schomburg Center, I participated in one of many convenings they held with librarians, historians, novelists, museum directors, and others, a range of voices as broad as Condoleezza Rice and Annette Gordon Reed. It was a call to action for the nation to address a general decline in humanities research, teaching, and learning. It found that too few parents are reading to young children, K through 12 social studies teachers, poorly trained, and that Americans have become more parochial, less worldly in their educational pursuits. They had no idea that Donald Trump would be our 45th president as a result. They noted nothing less than our civic culture, our workforce, and our national security are at stake. The humanities remind us where we have been and help us envision where we are going. Between 2005 and 11, they noted 50% reductions in federal funding for humanities. They say STEM fields, by contrast, were holding steady. And the old saying, follow the money, is indeed the quickest path to understanding our national priorities. But the problem runs deep in our body politic and knows no color line. In 1948, the great Harvard-trained historian and sociologist W.E.B. Du Bois told a room full of black men, the talented 10th, his Sigma Pi Phi or Boulé brothers, that they must choose personhood over profit if they were to help improve the condition of African Americans. Another Harvard alumnus, Carter G. Woodson, wrote about what he called the miseducation of the Negro in his most read 1933 book. He stated, in thus estimating the results obtained from the so-called education of the Negro, the author does not go to the census figures to show the progress of the race. It may be of no importance to the race to be able to boast today of many times as many educated members as it had in 1865, if they are of the wrong kind of increase in numbers. It will be a disadvantage rather than an advantage. The only question which concerns us here is whether these educated persons are actually equipped to face the ordeal before them, or unconsciously contribute to their own undoing by perpetuating the regime of the oppressor. In 2009, Ellis Coase analyzed the mood of Black America on the topic of race relations in the opening months of the Obama presidency. He held focus groups, did extensive interviewing, and mined available polling research to understand how three generations of African Americans saw the future. His two groups were Black Harvard Business School alumni and graduates of A Better Chance, a preparatory and pipeline to elite boarding school program for promising underprivileged youth. These are the same people today who were the target audiences for Carter Woodson and W.E.B. Du Bois so many decades ago. Coase found that older folks were optimistic, but much less so than younger folk. In this small example, we see the rough shape of the disappointment to come from hashtags I2MHarvard or hashtag Black Lives Matter. But the key insight of this work came in an appendix. These were the top 10 rules of success according to Black Harvard Business School alumni. Rule number one, you can only go so far as your networks will take you. Rule number four, embrace self-discipline and perseverance as virtues. Rule number seven, cultivate people who are more powerful and important than yourself. Rule number 10, never talk about race or gender if you can avoid it, other than to declare that race or gender does not matter. Isn't rule number 10 the grandest simplification? I think so. So did Dr. King. Here he wrote in Why We Can't Wait, published in the year of 1964, long before the Civil Rights Act had in fact been passed. It was very much still in question. It is the beginning of the Lord, at the beginning of the year of our Lord, 1963. I see a young Negro boy. He is sitting on a stoop in front of a vermin-infested apartment in Harlem. The stench of garbage is in the halls. The drunks, the jobless, the junkies are shadow figures of his everyday world. His father is one of the jobless. His mother, a sleep-in domestic working for a family on Long Island. I see a young Negro girl. She is sitting on the stoop of a rickety wooden one-family house in Birmingham. Some visitors would call it a shack. It needs paint badly, and the patched-up roof appears in danger of caving in. Half a dozen small children in various stages of undress are scampering about the house. The girl is forced to play the role of their mother. Her mother had recently died from a car accident because the ambulance came too late to take her to the all-Negro hospital. This boy and this girl, separated by stretching miles, are wondering, why does misery constantly haunt the Negro? In some distant past, had their forebears done some tragic injury to the nation? And was the curse of punishment upon the black race? Had blacks shirked their duty as patriots, betrayed their country, denied their national birthright? Had they refused to defend their land against a foreign foe? Not all of history, he wrote, is recorded in the books supplied to school children in Harlem or Birmingham. Yet this boy and this girl know something of the part of history which has been censored by the white writers and purchasers of Board of Education books. When I hear these words, I don't hear history so much as I hear echoes of the past reverberating in the pages of Ta-Nehisi Coates' work. Surprising to most, Dr. King's vision of transforming America did not just turn on moral appeals for justice, advocacy for civil rights legislation, and a massive push for economic equity. We know a lot about Dr. King's vision of a beloved community of universal brotherhood, too. What we've long overlooked was that before Dr. King had achieved the civil rights bills of 1964 and 5, when all he really had was the successful Montgomery bus boycott under his belt, he envisioned our shared history and collective memory at the cornerstone of transforming America. He went on to say the history books, which have almost completely ignored the contribution of the Negro in American history, have only served to intensify the Negro's sense of worthlessness and to augment the anachronistic doctrine of white supremacy. Coates says, in Between the World and Me, history is not just a cultural assault. In its erasure, it is not just about invisibility. The assault is also physical. You must always remember that the sociology, the history, the economics, the graphs, the charts, the regressions all land with great violence upon the black body. King may be on the mall, but the movement he was part of is still not taught in the vast majority of our nation's schools. In 2011, the Southern Poverty Law Center found that in a sample of 12,000 high school seniors, only 2% could answer correctly a two-part question. What was Brown versus Board of Education and why does it matter? 2% out of 12,000 seniors in a nationwide study. The Southern Poverty Law Center also noted that 16 states required no teaching whatsoever of civil rights history, none. 19 others did so little that they graded them as failures, and only 3 were model states. This didn't just happen, though. It was an intentional consequence of first federal backlash in the Department of Justice. Now we know, looking back through FOIA requests, that the FBI engaged in a counter-revolutionary campaign to destroy the legitimacy of black history. Mark Felt, who was the special agent in charge of the New York office, noted that communism had become less a problem than, quote, militant racial agitators who go about the land inciting riots and preaching and instigating anarchy and revolt. This new type of agitator evolved from unsettled racial and social conditions and composed a completely new set of problems which parallel the dangers presented by the pure communist elements. Felt attributed most racial disturbances to semi-professional hate mongers and rape rabble-rousers who spend much of their time waging war on the status quo and teaching the ghetto's receptive elements doctrines of hate. Out of this memo, he launched in 1968 ghetto listening posts to extend surveillance of rabble-rousers to include the employees and owners of taverns and liquor stores, drug stores and pawn shops, candy stores and barbershops. Men who were veterans of our armed forces, janitors of apartment buildings, newspaper, food and beverage distributors, taxi drivers, salesmen, The economic working class base of Black America at the time had now come under surveillance. Went on to then note that FBI officials routinely sent reports on organizations that received war on poverty funding. One report described a tutorial program for children in Memphis as a fraud, with an emphasis on teaching the Black and not constructive Black history. In Pittsburgh, special agents identified a grand total of two potential targets: the Afro-American Institute, a study group whose purpose is to promote an interest in Black culture, and the Organizers, a teenage group active in issuing public letters protesting the solicitation of Negro girls in ghetto areas by white males. New York identified fewer than 100 prospective targets, and even that number included members of groups with the sole mission of spreading African culture in Harlem. After the FBI's assault on the basic infrastructure of education of Black history in the communities of Harlem and Pittsburgh, came a broader culture war beginning in the late 1980s and 1990s, the very context in which I experienced as a student at the University of Pennsylvania. This was a culture war aimed squarely at the presence of Black students on elite campuses. This was a culture war aimed squarely at ethnic studies and Black studies and women's studies, captured memorably in Arthur Schlesinger's, the historian's, Disuniting of America, published in the early 1990s. And then a sustained, more recent discrediting, of which we are all bearing witness to today, where colleges and universities are bastions of liberal indoctrination, which manifests in holding hostage state budgets for land-grant colleges and universities, a double whammy for the humanities in light of federal cuts. Just to sample the recent past, we've all watched Texas whitewash its textbooks, taking out civil rights history and Chicano history. We've watched and witnessed Tucson, Arizona school district ban La Raza as anti-American to teach the descendants of Mexicans as Mexican-Americans in a place that was once part of Mexico as somehow contrary to an American multiracial project. We watched last year as a world geography book published by Macmillan belittled the significance of the Atlantic slave trade by noting in a melting pot of many immigrants to America that those who come from Africa worked hard to help build the nation as laborers. Scholastic published a book with happy slaves celebrating George Washington's birthday as they prepared a cake for him just a few months ago. And this week, Arizona is back in the news with House Bill 2120, where I quote, "A school district or charter school in this state shall not include in its program of instruction any courses, events, or activities that promote the overthrow of the United States government, promote division, resentment, or social justice towards a race, gender, religion, political affiliation, social class, or other class of people, are designed primarily for pupils of a particular ethnic group, advocate solidarity or isolation based on ethnicity, race, religion, gender, or social class instead of the treatment of pupils as individuals." Dr. King's legacy has spawned yet another counter-revolution. Since we have been divesting in humanities and discrediting Black history, it isn't a surprise that we have a Chief Justice of the Supreme Court today who thinks that the best way to end racism is to stop talking about race, or that congresspersons from Minneapolis's Michelle Bachmann, who believes that because enslaved people could be counted in the Confederacy, the Civil War had little to do with racism, or that a Brooklyn congresswoman thinks that slavery ended there in 1898. Congresswoman Yvette Clark was interviewed, some of you might recall, by Stephen Colbert on the Colbert Report, to which he said to her, "Some have called Brooklyn's decision to become part of New York City the great mistake of 1898. If you could get in a time machine," Colbert asked Yvette Clark, "and go back to 1898, what would you say to those Brooklynites?" She said, "I would say to them, set me free." Pressed by Colbert, "What would you be set free from?" She said slavery. He said, slavery, really? I didn't realize there was slavery in Brooklyn in 1898. Giving Clark a chance to step back from her remarks. She did not. She says, I'm pretty sure there was. It sounds like a horrible part of the United States that kept slavery going until 1898, Colbert continued. The lawmaker seemed to pause, saying, but Colbert kept going, asking, who would be enslaving you in 1898 in New York? Still not finished, Clark responded, the Dutch. Those sneaky Dutch bastards, Colbert said. Clark responded, exactly. As we laugh, we also witness the tragedy in a moment of recognizing that our national political leadership to be so ill-informed about this nation's past, even for a black woman. Boston Latin is the oldest high school in the nation, alma mater of founding fathers, is now currently under federal consent decree for civil rights abuses among its students. We also know, according to recent Yale researchers, that we can now track implicit bias in our preschool classrooms. We know that teachers treat black children differently as young as ages 3 and 4. And we also know that children themselves, as infants, begin to see race. They don't understand it. They don't know what to make of it, but they recognize it. This isn't just a problem for adults. And it's not just a problem, as I've already suggested, that black people must fix. The problem of historical illiteracy widens inequality in every direction. But blackness is at the core in this nation. Its management, its resiliency, its capacity to hold a mirror to the contradictions and failures of American democracy. My children and the students I teach breathe this air too. Once my 6-year-old daughter, whose name is Justice, said, I don't want to be black anymore, it is too hard. My 9-year-old son, in response to watching then Henry Louis Gates be arrested on the stoop of his own home, asked me, will white people put us back in slavery? And my first semester at IU started with a student giving me the middle finger because she didn't like the discussion of Northern segregation. My last semester ended at Indiana University with a student writing in the course evaluation that I should kill myself in order to improve my instruction. Channeling the late historian John Hope Franklin, President Drew Faust of Harvard University wrote in a recent New York Review book of essays, New York Review of Books essay, Race and the Meaning of America, that fundamental to the task at hand would be rewriting the history of history, revising the hallowed falsehoods, illustrating how the abuse and misuse of history served to legitimate systems of oppression, not just in the past, but in the present as well. Until we have a new history, we cannot build a different and better future. There cannot be reparations. Faust states, it is history that has the capacity to save us. After all, this is about my children, about your children, about our children. This is about the world we will build for them. We can't fix inequality if we rear children to value inequality. The writer Juno Diaz told me that from teaching MIT students, he learned that history was their weakest muscle. He's right. If we invest and insist on historical literacy of all our children, they will change our origin story, our narrative of inequality, of winners and losers, makers and takers. They will make political and economic decisions, as Dr. King insisted, that value personhood and over profit. At President Obama's farewell speech to an enormous hometown crowd in Chicago, he evoked for the last time the American creed as the foundation upon which our democracy rests. Like all of his 7 State of the Union addresses and 2 inaugural speeches, Obama has always embraced a vision of America as greater than the sum of its red and blue, black and white, Latino and Asian parts. His America has been nothing but exceptional in its capacity to change and make life better for those who follow and for those who, as he wrote, work hard and take responsibility. Using melting pot metaphors, insisting upon the rejection of any politics that targets race or religion, not unlike HB 2120 in Arizona, and constantly referencing the shared patriotism of our multiracial troops, Obama has never wavered in his belief that we are one people with common hopes and a common creed. In fulfilling the duties of the office with great dignity and self-respect, the nation's first black president represented the highest expression of the civil rights era goal of assimilation. For many Americans, Obama perfectly embodied the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., celebrated this time of year, in whom the president praised at last year's State of the Union address for his unarmed truth and unconditional love. For nearly two generations, our national memory of Dr. King has reinforced the belief in American exceptionalism, of the capacity of this nation, unlike any other, to extend democracy and opportunity to every individual, regardless of their identity. In King's name, assimilation and aspiration have been the keynotes of the post-civil rights era. Diversity and inclusion have been its currency. In Obama's singular excellence, he has symbolized more than any individual in American history how racial representation and the content of one's character are the perfect antidotes to racism. But we were mistaken, and we must now confront the end of an era and the dawn of a new one. Welcome to post-assimilation America. Just as there had never been an America with a black president, now there will never be an America without one. The half-century-old rules and standard operating procedures for racial advancement are now obsolete. There is no racial barrier left to be broken. There is no office in the land black firsts can ascend, from mayors to governors to attorney generals, and now the presidency, that will serve as a magical platform for saving black or brown people and the soul of a nation from its racist past. America's institutions cannot be made over by simply dressing them up in more shades of brown and expecting a more just and equitable outcome. In this new era, the structures of our society and the values of our institution are the challenges we must now unflinchingly confront. Obama's election in 2008 was, by any historical measure, the capstone and high water mark of the civil rights period. So many black and white, Latino and Asian Americans saw him as the fulfillment of Dr. King's vision. Who can forget the sight of King's former aide, Reverend Jesse Jackson, shedding tears at the celebration of the newly elected first black president in Chicago's Grant Park? The very notion that all the brutality, blood, courage, and sacrifice of civil rights activists a half century ago had led to this moment was captured by the iconography of the campaign. T-shirts adorned in red, white, and blue glitter with Dr. King and President Obama's profiles side by side flooded city streets from Atlanta to Chicago. Bold worded posters of dream realized, fulfilling the dream, and dreams do come true lined the hallways of urban schools across America. The liturgy of the age captured in verse, Rosa sat so Martin could walk, Martin walked so Obama could run, Obama ran so our children can fly. With many of our schools more segregated and our politics more racially polarized since the 1960s, most people would agree that the Obama years have not lived up to the promises of 2008. But high expectations and blind faith in the symbolism of Obama's election were born out of the mythos, out of the tyranny of ignorance of our past, where assimilation and aspiration were simply all we needed to move forward. But the exceptionalism of his biography and the belief in a manifest destiny toward a more perfect union has ballast through the storms of the Tea Party Revolution, congressional obstructionism, state violence, voting restrictions, Islamophobia, nativist hysteria, binge incarceration, and poverty not seen since Dr. King's ill-fated Poor People's March failed to right the ship of our racial state. We know now we cannot escape our history. Obama was an avatar for all the hope and racial change for which Dr. King died. Along the corridors of the Martin Luther King Jr. streets and boulevards were economic and educational divestment, infrastructure decay, and premature death are so readily apparent. You can tally the collective impact of all those hopes and possibilities. There is no straight line of progress from Seneca Falls to Selma to Stonewall, and no singularly exceptional individual can bend the moral arc of the universe. Not even Dr. King could. The Remember Dr. King we celebrate this time of year was indeed the symbolic beacon of the movement, but the Forgotten King worked hand in glove within the institutions dedicated to transforming a broken system and a sick society. He never positioned himself as a paragon of progress, nor did he allow others the comfort of complacency. His own retelling of the movement and its limits made it plain that delusion and retrenchment had already set in after 1965. In his last book, Where Do We Go From Here, Chaos or Community, Dr. King warned that, quote, as we've heard earlier, the majority of white Americans consider themselves sincerely committed to justice for the Negro. They believe that American society is essentially hospitable to fair play and to steady growth toward a middle-class utopia embodying racial harmony. But unfortunately, this is a fantasy of self-deception and comfortable vanity. Despite what so many of King's admirers have believed, individual assimilation was never the goal. King's unarmed troop, after the movement's victory dust had settled, even before the greatest racialized prison boom the world has ever known commenced, was to remake the whole of American society. We must be, he insisted, those creative dissenters who will call our beloved nation to a higher destiny, to a new plateau of compassion, to a more noble expression of humanness. His unconditional love was for a nation of individuals and institutions that could and must do better. So what does creative dissent look like in a post-assimilation America? First, we must recognize that institutions are far more powerful than individuals, no matter how many people of color can be counted in leadership. Structural inequality and racism are immune to identity politics. Rising to the top should no longer fuel the comfortable vanity of fair play. The ascent of attorney generals, Eric Holder and Loretta Lynch, were the starting points for the possibility of federal criminal justice reform, not the reform in and of itself. Second, history matters. Black people in charge of or embedded in systems that have not reconciled with their institutional history can make those systems less responsive to claims of racial bias. Unless you are the chief diversity officer, the path to leadership has often meant accepting institutions as they are, not disrupting them. Just after Obama's first election, as I've mentioned, a focus group of Black Harvard MBAs told the journalists to ignore race and gender. From the failures of Black political leadership in Freddie Gray's Baltimore to the limits of C-suite Black representation in Black police departments, people of color can inherit or perpetuate structures of inequality. Diversity and inclusion policy should grow out of truth and reconciliation practices rather than strategic hiring plans. Many of these institutions of government, of finance, of higher education, as we've already noted, often built on the backs of the enslaved, remain to this day haunted by them, as the creative dissenters of our various campuses have made clear. Intentional transformation and reparations, one government agency, one company, one college at a time, moves us past the failure of imagination to act, moves us past the denial, the ephemeral apologies, and the empty promises to improve, moves us closer to where Dr. King wanted America to go. Bringing down the Confederate flag in South Carolina is also an expression of creative dissent in this new era. It is the beginning of institutional change led by two women of color. What Bree Newsom started, Governor Nikki Haley finished. Racist state speech is not the same as private speech and should not represent any government entity in the United States. Similarly, each college should decide what to do with emblems of slavery or the names of individuals who promoted and perpetuated white supremacy. Georgetown University's unprecedented decision to reconcile with its past is an expression of creative dissent. Last year, President John DeGioia met with descendants of the 272 enslaved people owned by the university, of which 56 were sold in 1838 to avert financial ruin. He stated, "As a community and as individuals, we cannot do our best if we refuse to take ownership of such a critical part of our history." Not only will Georgetown no longer ignore and deny this truth, as he noted, it will build a public memorial to the enslaved men and women who helped build and save the institution. It will establish an institute for the study of slavery, America's greatest economic engine, and as a step towards reparations, the university will provide preferential admissions to descendants akin to legacy admits for the children of alumni. After all, they're really the children of alumni. Colleges and universities should take heed. The measure of institutional change will not simply be a new diversity task force or increased black and brown faculty. These schools need to be more honest with their own histories in order to create new legacies. They need updated origin stories on their websites, revised promotional literature, and new docent scripts for campus tour guides to inspire students to remake the future that it might be better than the past. There are still no guarantees. It won't be easy to look for transformation by how our institutions behave on behalf of individuals rather than the other way around. Some of the millennials and creative dissenters of the Black Lives Matter movement have already embraced the possibilities of the new era. We don't need more elected officials that are just black. We have city council. We need champions in the city, says Charlene Carruthers, national director of the Black Youth Project 100 in Chicago. To business leaders, Brittany Packnett of Campaign Zero, a police reform advocacy group, asks, "Will you institute company practices that prioritize true equity, or will you settle for cosmetic diversity and tokenize people of color?" These activists see themselves continuing Dr. King's unfinished work. Quote, "We stand in Martin Luther King Jr.'s legacy," writes Packnett. "For them, this is not about branches, but instead uprooting the tree of racism. No more business as usual." We made our government write new laws to alter some of the cruelest injustices that affected us, King instructed in 1967, looking back at the history of the movement of which he was such a critical part. We made an indifferent and unconcerned nation rise from lethargy and subpoenaed its conscience. This was the blueprint of how creative dissenters of the civil rights generation actually expanded the meaning and practice of a multiracial, multiethnic democracy. It is impossible to imagine marriage equality or greater gender equity or even the possibility of racial justice and economic fairness today without it. The political scientist Michael Dawson calls Dr. King's late stage blueprint, quote, "a glittering, sharply edged vision of a robust, radical social democracy." This was a political tradition rooted in institutions of black civil society from which King drew and expected to pay forward. Indeed, Dr. King challenged the nation to end cultural homicide, his words, what he described as, quote, "the tendency to ignore the contributions of black people to American life." Pause on that for a moment. Cultural homicide, a whole new spin on the violence of America. Just in the end, as there might not have been an Obama without a King, we might still be stuck in the era of assimilation without Obama. And the good news is that President Obama, now our former president, or soon to be, seems ready to move on. In his final speech to the nation, there was no more self-congratulatory praise for an America that gave him a chance to be president. Instead, he acknowledged for the first time the very real threat of racism to our democracy and the contingent nature of racial progress. For the first time, he mocked the notion of a post-racial America that was never realistic. In a revision to the American creed, he added, equality may be self-evident, but it has never been self-executing. And for the first time in any of his State of the Union or inaugural addresses, he enumerated specific areas to combat systemic racism. Call it reparations of a sort. If we're going to be serious about race going forward, we must uphold laws against discrimination in hiring and in housing and in education and in the criminal justice system. So what now? In this post-assimilation America, we will take our history seriously. We will be called to the obligations, the responsibilities, and the burdens of wrestling deeply with our shared American past. And for those of us who happen to be headed for leadership as the demographics of the nation inexorably change, they must be creative dissenters by actively rejecting their own individual access and achievement as the core measure of progress. They must instead use history as a tool to measure institutional and systemic change. In criminal justice, for example, they must end racist policies of mass criminalization and mass incarceration, knowing and reconciling the history of explicit discrimination, implicit bias, and enduring racial double standards, now on full display as politicians call for an end to the war on drugs as addiction sweeps white America. To proceed in any other way, even in just this one institutional arena of American society, is to perpetuate the fantasy of self-deception that Dr. King rejected. The future is no longer about firsts. It is instead about the content of the character of the institutions our new leaders will help us to carry forward. Thank you.
My presence here is brief and twofold. First is to, with genuine indeed, for all of us to give another round of applause to the outstanding speech by Dr. Muhammad. And second is to thank everyone for being here this morning. And as Dean Auer has outlined and President Spencer has referenced, we encourage you to go to the programs across today. And we thank you for being here, and we'll all move forward from here. Thank you.